So again, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining me in this session on data science with R for Java developers. I assume you all have a development background. For myself, I'm a Java developer. I've been developing in Java for about 10 years now. And I became interested in the whole data science field a few years ago. And as we will see, R, the open source language for statistical computing, is one of the leading languages in this data science world. There are others as well, but I think this one is pretty interesting. And we'll see some hands-on of that. I'll explain language. If we look at the agenda, then I'd like to start with talking about data science itself, because we all heard the term. And actually, I believe it's really a hyped term currently, meaning that everybody talks about it. But it means different things to different people. And we'll try and explore and see what data science is all about. After that, I'll introduce you guys to the R language. Like I said, it's a open source language for statistical programs. And that doesn't mean that half of the time your program will fail, fortunately. No, it just means that it has many, many libraries and many facilities for doing statistics. And it turns out that statistics and other related fields are really the basis of what data scientists do daily. So assuming a lot of you come from a Java development background, towards the end of the presentation, we'll see how you can apply the knowledge that we've learned with R in a Java development environment. So these are the main three parts. I'll try in between these parts to have a look at your questions and answer them if possible. If not, I'll catch it in the end and we'll have a Q&A then. So first, a little bit more about me. I work as a senior software engineer at Luminous Technologies, which is a company in the Netherlands. Currently, I'm working on a fairly large educational system in the Netherlands. And actually, that's where also a lot of data science questions are arising as well. Because education is not only about delivering content, it's also about understanding what's happening in your system. So besides working as a software engineer at Luminous Technologies, I also author articles for the Dutch Java magazine and sometimes other publications as well. I run a blog at branchandbound.net. And you can take a look if you're interested in the things you're hearing and seeing. And in other related events, I like sharing knowledge as well. For example, JavaBorn, KubeCon, etc. So if you happen to be at KubeCon New York and next month, drop by, say hi, and let's talk. So enough about me. What about this whole data science thing? A while ago, I read a report which stated that about 90% the current world's data was produced in the last 2 years. And really, if you think about it, that's a mind-boggling number. I mean, we're producing data at such a large rate that we really have to question ourselves, what are we doing with this data? Because if I look at most of the projects that I've worked on in the past years, then mostly we're interested in creating a business application, applying business rules, making sure that everything is transactionally safe, making sure that our application is scalable and that we manage our data. But actually, customers and people using our applications are expecting more and more. Take a look, for example, what they experience with Facebook, with Google. Those applications really try to learn from what you are doing in their systems to tailor their delivery to you better. Take the Facebook timeline with all its smarts that are behind it, and you have an idea what I mean. So let me give another example. Let's say that you wanted to create a large online email system, right? So as a developer, the first things that I think about is, okay, then I need to create a flashy AX-enabled front end. I need a scalable backend to store my emails, maybe to search through them quickly. I need a super robust SMTP implementation, etc., etc. But if you actually look at Gmail currently, that's not the killer application. The killer application of Gmail is everything that they built on top of this using data science techniques. For example, a priority inbox. How on earth are you going to sort emails into a priority? Think, for example, even about the ads that Google is showing. They're really tailored to you. They're really tailored to your context. These are all things that you're not going to solve with simple SQL queries. I think we all can understand that. So obviously, we need to go beyond just the create, read, update, and delete that we mostly think about when architecting and developing business applications. So this data science term. Like I said, we've all heard it, we all know it, but what does it even mean? I mean, does it have anything to do with data? Well, yes, obviously, because like I talked about previously, data is the cornerstone of all these new experiences that you can create for your customers and for your users. On the other hand, does it have anything to do with science? I mean, science is mostly about creating hypotheses, doing experiments, doing it all in a very controlled setting in a very principled manner, peer reviews, very solid, very rigorous. Well, that's not really what I see when I see data scientists at work. When I see data scientists at work, I see people who are trying to apply some scientific techniques to lots of data and try to get out the knowledge that they want. So it's really not a science in that sense. Still, data science has caught on as a term, so I'm going to keep using it, and a lot of other people are going to keep using it. Let's just all agree that it's not really, mostly not science what's happening there. It's just broadening your skills and broadening your vision on what you can do with data. So what other things can you think about when you talk about data science? One thing that you can think about is, for example, automatic classification of data. So to give an example, I run a website, scalabits.com, which automatically retrieves articles about Scala programming language from a Bitly API. And in this API, I also get back lots of non-Scala related results. So currently, what I had is an automatic approval system where each article was put in front of me and I said, yeah, okay, publish it. No, don't publish it, not related. These are the typical things where you can apply machine learning algorithms, for example, to do text mining, data mining on your text and automatically classify, should I publish this article or shouldn't I publish this article? Other areas which are really popular for applications with data science are recommendation engines. For example, whenever you check out at Amazon, they always add something. Okay, well, other people who bought this also bought, and they use lots of data to cook up these recommendations. So those are already two very different domains, but they all use the same tools and techniques. So actually, if you look at the skill sets that a real data scientist has to have, they're pretty diverse, to say the least. And I'm not claiming that I'm currently in the middle of this diagram, but if you look at various combinations of these skills, I think we all come from the red, right? From the hacking skills, developers, architects, people who know how to create scalable applications, how to create robust applications. On the other hand, there are also, at least in academia, lots of people who are really good at math and statistics, and also are kind of good at creating software and developing. And that's where the whole field of machine learning actually happens. So these people are really trying to come up with generic algorithms that they can let loose on any kind of data set, for example, to create recommendations or to predict new data points based on old data points. So to get started with data science, you really have to have a solid background in math and statistics as well. For example, linear algebra is a really big part of most of the algorithms that are used in data science. And on the other hand, of course, statistics. When we talk about large quantities of data, we're not really going to look at everything. We're going to look at aggregates, means, standard deviations, etc., etc. And there you really have to know your statistics as well. On the other hand, in traditional businesses, there were lots of people who have this math and statistics background as well, but also had a lot of domain expertise. For example, if you take the field of forecasting flights, like the flight operators, Russian Airlines, KLM, or whatever. And those people really have to optimize their whole schedule. And to do this, they use statistics and domain expertise. And traditionally, this combination is called operations research. Sometimes it also touches upon business intelligence, which is also a fairly established role in organizations. And these together are also part of what a data scientist does. You really have to know the domain of the data that you're working on to really create good conclusions. On the other hand, there's also a very dangerous zone here, which is when you are a domain expert and you have some hacking skills, and that's usually where the Microsoft Access or Excel warriors come along, or the Perl hackers or whatever. So there's all kinds of possible combinations. And I think we're in as software developers, coming from right the software development, the hacking skills background, we're in a very good position to also move into the math and statistics. And of course, if you're a product developer, you also have domain expertise. So you can really use that to your advantage and grow into this data science role if you want to. So this tweet really hits home for me, at least. It's a definition of what is a data scientist. It is a person who is better at statistics than any software engineer and better at software engineering than any statistician. So, well, there you have it. If you happen to be that person, then you're worth your weight in gold currently. So what if you want to get started in data science? What should you do? Well, probably you can't read all the individual labels on this, but this is a very nice chart someone made of all the subtopics within data science that you could study in order to become good at it. And it starts with things like, how do we actually collect my data? And basics like, what are the linear algebra fundamentals that I need to know? What are the statistics backgrounds that I have to have? Moving on to what kinds of machine learning algorithms are there, et cetera, et cetera. So obviously, we cannot talk about all of that today. Today, I'm going to introduce you to a toolset, R, open source language, and RStudio, which is an IDE that you can use, also freely available for R development. So even though we're just seeing a very small part of the whole field of data science, I think it can give you a feel of what's possible. And if you're interested, at least this picture shows that there's infinite possibilities to explore there. So with that, let's move on to some R introduction. And actually, I think it's fair to give you a warning before we move on with R as a language. Because it seems that R has been developed by statisticians, and there seems to be very, very little overlap between the area of actual GUs, programming language designers, and statisticians. And sadly, R was not developed on the intersection of these two groups, meaning the language itself really isn't a great programming language. Especially if you compare it with, for example, Java, where we have at least a Java language specification and a Java language platform architect, someone who oversees all the changes and all the evolution and all everything that's happening with Java as a language. Well, not so much with R. R was initially developed by two professors at a New Zealand university somewhere in the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s. So even though it predates Java as a language, I really wouldn't say it's a great programming language from a language design perspective. So yeah, what are you going to do? I mean, we can of course wait until this mythical creature in the middle of this picture emerges, playing the guitar or something, whatever it's called. But in the end, it's about getting the job done, and R really has taken its place in the community as a big ecosystem. So it's not just a language, it's a combination of the language and all the libraries that are available that make R a great environment to actually learn from your data and to do data science. So to be fair, there are some initiatives currently brewing in the data science world that may deliver sometime a better language than R, with the same libraries, etc., etc. One of those is Julia. And on the other hand, Python also gets more and more add-ons that make it really a nice language for data science. But if you look at R, it's still, at least in my opinion, the champion there. It's the biggest in terms of the number of libraries, etc. So even though it's not a great language, you really should take a look at it if this is what you want to do and where you want to go. Someone at Google phrased it like this: the best thing about R is that it was developed by statisticians, and the worst thing about R is that it was developed by statisticians. So there you have it. So that being said, why should you use R then? Well, like I said, it's the de facto standard currently for doing statistical programming, especially when you look at academical research. Lots and lots of statistical papers come with R source code as a first implementation of cutting-edge new statistical techniques. So that means if you use R, there's always a new and fancy package to do more and more advanced analysis. Also, it's an open source language, which is, of course, really, really handy. Actually, R was created as a reaction to a closed source statistical language called S, I believe. So really, it's open source all the way, and you can do whatever you want with it. And the nice thing about R is that it's not just a programming language, as we will see later, but it's also a tool for interactive data exploration, meaning that you can really take your data and look around and play with it. And really, that's the essence of data science, in my opinion, as well. It's not just implementing some algorithm and hoping for the best. It's taking your data, collecting it, cleaning it, because data often has some dirty aspects to it that you have to clean up before you go go perform your analysis on it. And then you go and try things. And really, if you have to write Java code, compile it, and run it somewhere every time you want to try something, that's really not a very nice way to work with data exploration. You really want a interactive environment in which you get quick feedback and you really can play around. So in the end, R, it is a general purpose programming language, but it's really posing as a sort of a domain specific language for data, for data science, for statistical programming. And even though you could write a web server in it, I really wouldn't recommend it. Just use it as a data exploration and data analysis tool. On the other hand, there are also reasons why you shouldn't pick R. And that has mainly to do with the fact that it's slow. it's memory bound, meaning that the data sets that you're going to load have to fit in your actual current working memory. So these are really pain points if you're going to think about what we, of course, call big data nowadays. And in the end of the presentation, I'll give some pointers about how to circumvent this. One other point is that R is not really a great name for a programming language. I mean, if you try Googling for it, it's really horrible. But anyway, probably didn't think of that in the 90s yet. And like I said, it's really a quirky language, meaning that it is not as nicely designed as something like Java. However, you might think about Java, at least there's an architecture behind it. There's a design philosophy. And well, in R, it's more of a combination of things that glue together and that aren't really designed in that sense. One last pointer here is that the preface of this, if you are using R and you think you're in hell, this is a map for you. This comes from a PDF you can download freely called the R Inferno. And if you start using R, really read this. It contains all the pitfalls and everything to watch out for in R as a language. So how do you get started? Well, you go to the website of the R language, and you're greeted by a website that's really hasn't been updated. At least the design hasn't been updated since the 1990s as well. So apparently statisticians are not just only not language designers, they're not designers either. Well, anyway, fortunately, you only have to get here once. You have to download R, install it, and what you get then is what we'll get in the next slide, an interactive interpreter that you can use. So what does the R language look like? Let's compare and contrast it with Java, which I assume you're all familiar with. But before moving on, I'm going to check if there are any questions in the Q&A. Okay, so it doesn't seem like there are any questions, so I'm going to continue with the presentation here, in which we are going to compare and contrast R with Java. And excuse me, I'll move one Q&A window out of my way. There we go again. So at the top you see R started in my console just as an interactive REPL, redeveloped print loop, like we also know from, for example, Groovy or other dynamic languages that you may be familiar with. And what you see here is that you can just type code, hit enter, it will be evaluated, and you'll get a response back. This means that R is, so it's an interpreted language, which is quite different from Java, which is, of course, a compiled language, with all the advantages and disadvantages that go with a interpreted language. I already told you that R is slow. Well, most interpreted languages are on the slow side, and that's one of the reasons. If you look at the paradigm of the language, then of course Java is object-oriented. R, on the other hand, can't really make up its mind. And this already shows what I told earlier, it's a quirky language, it's evolved from something not really designed up front. So it has functional aspects, it has some object-oriented aspects, and it even goes so far that R doesn't have just one object system. No, it has two or maybe even three different object systems, which are, of course, really somewhat compatible, but not completely. And you even can just code procedurally, just a list of instructions and go, go, go. Like I said, dynamic evaluated versus static compiled in Java. And that's really an advantage if you look at quick turnaround times and experimenting. But it's a disadvantage if you look at execution times and really scalability of the R runtime. So if you look a bit deeper at the data types that are inside of R, then you can see that, for example, where we have in Java, integers, doubles, etc. In R, there's really a numeric type, which sort of encompasses these numeric types. There's a string type, which is called character. And there's this is quite important. There's also the notion of a factor with FA, not VE. A factor is really sort of the equivalent of an enum in Java. And it turns out that in most data sets, it's really important to treat strings as factors, just so you get correct groupings and correct interpretation of your data set. So that's also a core type in R language. Furthermore, in Java, we don't have any more really native types. Everything that you write is a class, so we have classes implementing lists and maps and etc. in Java. On the other hand, R has some more native data types, one of which is a vector, this time with VE, and this vector is just a container type. This contains multiple elements of, in this case, the same type. List on the is also a container type, but in this case, a list may contain elements of different types. And one very interesting data type in R is the data frame. And the closest analogy that I have for the data frame is that of a relational table in databases. So really, a data frame is several columns, which can have different data types. And the columns can have names, like in a relational database table. And then you can have as many rows as you want. Of course, this is an ideal representation of data sets inside R. And there are many ways to slice and dice and to work with these data frames, as we'll see later. So one thing that gets developers and computer scientists really worked up is the whole zero-based versus one-based discussion. In this case, Java, of course, uses zero-based indexing in arrays and lists, etc. Well, R chooses differently. R chooses for one-based indexing. And this is going to bite you very often if you make the switch from a zero-based language to a one-based language. You get the off-by-one errors. You try to get the zero index and it doesn't exist, etc. On the other hand, since R is functional as well, we're not really iterating over data sets element by element, often by ourselves using for loops, etc. But you can use functions like apply in this case, where you have a vector vec and you want to apply plus one to each element, and you can just supply the function with plus one in the body. And you don't have to worry about what index your values in the vector are. On the other hand, using for loops in Java, you often have to think about indexing. Although with Java 8 and the whole streams and functional interfaces, etc., all these additions make this a bit less of a problem in Java as well. So another big difference is that in Java, parameters are evaluated eagerly. Before your function is called, everything is evaluated and passed in as a reference. On the other hand, R uses more of a lazy evaluation module of whatever computation you put into functions. Another difference there is that Java has this pass by reference semantics to methods. So if you pass an object, you're not actually passing a copy of the object, but just a reference to this object. On the other hand, R is a pass by value language, which means that every value that you pass to a new function is copied, and the function will get its own copy of the value that you put in as a parameter. Now, of course, it will be really expensive to do this if you have large data sets and you want to pass this around. So fortunately, there's a optimization implemented in the R runtime where when you pass this data set, this large data set, to a function, it's not actually copied at the moment that this function is called. It's only copied if this function actually modifies the data set that you're passing in. So that makes passing around a large data set not as expensive as you would think using parameter-value semantics. Now, if you look beyond the language, if you look at the ecosystem, then, of course, in Java land, we're spoiled with choice. We have lots of IDEs. We have lots of really great open source projects that we can use, like Eclipse and NetBeans, and also fairly nice IDEs in the commercial space, like IntelliJ, which I'm a big fan of. On the other hand, if you look at R, there are not just that many options. You have RStudio, which I will show you in a bit, which is a really nice environment. But well, there's just not as much choice between great IDEs as in Java. If you look at the library ecosystem, then in Java land we have mostly Maven Central as a central hub for all Java libraries, and there's lots of Java libraries. On the R side, we have CRAN, the Comprehensive RF Network. And this is really what I talked about earlier, and this is the place where all these great and cutting-edge statistical libraries live. So currently they have about, I believe, 3,500 packages in there, and these are all high-quality, mostly high-quality packages with, for example, machine learning algorithms, visualization, data visualization tools, and all kinds of stuff that can really help you to understand your data. So I think that's enough talking. Let's switch to RStudio and see what it looks like in practice. So what I've brought up here is RStudio, and RStudio is divided in four panes, three of which are visible currently. Here I'm in my interactive R interpreter, my console. On the side are two views that I will explain later. We also have an integrated source editor here, which I can open. We'll get back to that later. But as you can see, you can just edit the source files. And when you save it, it's automatically loaded into your R interpreter here on the bottom. So of course, being good programmers, the first thing we're going to do is try and create a Hello World program. Well, since an expression is also a valid R code, and we're creating a literal string here, right, that works, we get hello world. But question is, what is this strange brackets with one from? What does it even mean? Well, it turns out that R doesn't really have single valued variables, single valued values. So I cannot just have a bare string. Actually, what I got back here when I typed this hello world was a vector of length 1 containing the hello world string. Now, I can even create this vector by hand by using the C function around it, and C creates a vector in this case. We'll get exactly the same result as before. I can even create very large vectors. In this case, I'm using a simple range syntax, so I want to have the numbers 1 through 100. I can do that. And as you can see now, I have even more brackets here. And you can see that in this case, the 1 indicates that this is position 1. This is position 25 in the vector, 49, etc. So you can quickly see where you are. Now, like I said, vectors all have to be of the same type. All elements have to be of the same type. With lists, you can have elements of different types. But what if you want to deconstruct a vector and want to get an element out? Well, in this case, I can, for example, create a three-element vector, and I want to have the first element. And of course, I have to index it with 1, not 0. Remember, it's a 1-based indexing language. And in this case, we'll get back the first element. But as you might recall, we don't have single valued values. So this 1 actually isn't just 1, it's also a vector again. So in this case, we can write the equivalent expression here, and we will get back the same result. Of course, you can do the same with multiple values. And that's the nice thing about R. Everything works on vectors as values just as well as it does on single elements, because of the fact that you don't really have single elements, you only have vectors of one. So in this case, if you give it a vector 1, 2, you'll get back the first two elements. Now, another nice thing is that the operators are vectorized. So if I want to negate the selection of my vector here, I can just put minus in front of the vector that I create here, which actually means this: give me everything except what is at position 1 and 2 of this vector. So I'll get back 6. So what I did here is precisely equivalent to defining the negative numbers inside. So as you can see already, R is a bit different in a sense that all operations are what I'd like to call vector ready or vectorized. And what if you want to have variables? Well, we can have variables. We can have an A, and we assign a ray to it. And like as you can see, the arrow is the most often used assignment syntax. And what happens here is that a variable is created, and I can, of course, reference it again and get it back. We can see also here on the right-hand side that this variable also appears in what is called a workspace. And that's one cool thing about R. You're not just evaluating things here in void. No, there's a workspace which contains everything you've done up to now. And you can even save this workspace, serialize it, send it to someone, and they can pick it up where you left it off. So it's really an extension of your interactive environment in a way that can be saved and shared as well. Now, of course, it's not something that we usually do. We usually use source code sharing, et cetera, but still it's a nice thing if you think about it. That really makes it more of, I've heard R being described as a headless Excel on steroids as well. So an Excel in which you actually program, which has much, much more libraries and options, but really you're making a worksheet here and you're doing some interactive development on a shared workspace. Now, just to illustrate the point of the vectorized operations, I can also do addition, for example, on these vectors, which, of course, give the expected result. What would happen if I do plus 1? Well, every element is incremented with 1, which is kind of strange because I'm adding two vectors here with different lengths. And what actually happens here is that R recycles this 1 and uses it for every element in the list. And it happily adds it to each element. Now, what happens if I have 1, 2, for example, here? Well, it just happily recycles 1, 1 is 2, 2 plus 2 is 4, and I'm at 3. Well, I'm going to just reuse one of this vector again. And then, okay, well, maybe I have one element left. I'll just print a warning. I mean, we're dynamic language, right? So this is really something that can bite you, at least in my experience. Now, these are all really basic operations. Also built in the language are statistical operations. For example, want to have a mean of 1 through 10? Easy. Just call mean. On the other hand, another notion that often appears in data sets is that of missing values. So in this case, I'm going to create a list of 1 to 10, and one element appears to be missing, which is indicated with the syntax NA here, not available. And what happens then is that mean says, okay, if you have a data set with 11 data points and one is not available, then technically I cannot calculate a mean. So of course, that's valid from a mathematical perspective. But in all practicality, you often want to use the mean of the elements that are available. And in that case, you can specify an additional argument. NA.rm is true. And in this case, you can also see that the second argument that I'm passing it by name. So R also has by name parameters on functions. And in this case, I'll happily get back the same mean that I got from the list without the not available as well. So some more statistical operations. Give me some random variables normally distributed. So it's like taken from the bell curve that we all know. So for example, give me 10 of these normal distributed random values and give me 10 different ones. It really doesn't matter. In this case, it assumes a standard deviation of 1 and a mean of 0, which is quite a default normal distribution. And you can tune that yourself as well. Now, lots of languages have packages or implementations of these simple statistics. R really goes further, and it also provides lots of different distributions. For example, if you want to have 10 random variables from the Poisson distribution, no problem, it's built in as well. You still have to specify a lambda rate, and a Poisson distribution is a distribution of non-negative count values. So for example, if you want to model the hits to your website, well, this will never be fractional and will never be negative. So you could use, for example, this distribution. If you get average 100 visitors per day, you can model a random variable based on this Poisson distribution. So there's lots and lots of more of this built in, and that's really handy if you're just poking out your data set and trying to use it. Now, just to illustrate the functional aspect of the language, let's have a look at the built-in letters data set, which is, of course, just the letters of the alphabet. And in this case, I can, for example, say, give me a random sample of 10 of the letters and give me a different sample. Now, if you want to make this repeatable, you have to set the random seed. And if you do that and sample it, and you set the seed to the same seed again, and you sample it again, you get the same result back, which is very handy if you want to create reproducible results. Now, we can also take this letter set and use some functional R to turn it into uppercase. So if we want to map a function over a vector, we can use the sapply. And we say map, for example, the function, which in this case is an anonymous inline function, function element to upper element, which gives us back a list of all the uppercase elements. And of course, since it's a functional language, we really don't have to write this boilerplate, this function implementation around it. We can also pass just a reference to the function. So in this case, we just apply the toUpper function to all the letters in the letters data set, and we get the same result. And of course, for someone who paid close attention, you can of course also exploit the fact that toUpper doesn't just work on single elements, but it can also work on a vector of elements. So the easiest solution in this case would of course be just to call toUpper on the whole list, and you get back that list into uppercase. In this case, we've been doing pretty basic operations. I'd like to show some more, I wouldn't say advanced, but it's more in the sense that you're really exploring data. For example, if we look at a built-in data set called empty cars, we can show, I'm going to show just the beginning of this data set to you, which is a very nice data set containing cars, miles per gallon, cylinders, and all kinds of other stuff about cars. In RStudio, I can even use the GUI to explore this data set quickly, where you have a nice table and you can do some more than just in text. And in this case, I'm very interested in the relation between the horsepower of cars and the miles per gallon. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a plot called a qplot, and I'm going to take the horsepower column of the empty cars dataset, and this dollar means that I'm going to select a column of this data frame, because this empty cars is actually a built-in data frame that we talked about earlier. And I'm going to plot it against the miles per gallon of all cars. So what happens then is that RStudio actually picks up this plot and puts it in a nice spot for us where we can see all the data points. And as expected, the cars with the highest miles per gallon are really the cars that have the lowest amount of horsepower. And the absolute supercars with more than 300 horsepower have a really lousy fuel efficiency. So in this case, that sort of makes sense. And we can try to confirm our intuition by looking at an example to the correlation between the horsepower and the empty cars miles per gallon. And correlation is actually a single value that indicates by minus maximum, if it's minus one, it indicates a completely negative correlation. Zero means uncorrelated data, and one means a completely positive correlation. So in this case, we would expect that the correlation is negative, and that's confirmed by this correlation call, which gives us back a correlation of minus 0.77. So we can even try to visualize this this relation by adding a so-called line of best fit to the graph, and we're going to use a linear model in this case, which just means it's trying to find a line of best fit in this data set among the values there. It also shows nicely the confidence intervals for the values. So nothing is certain, of course, and it's, it helps you with that. But just because there's a line of best fit doesn't really mean that it's really a useful line, right? So let's try and explore it a bit more in this graph. Let's try to see whether the amount of cylinders in the car also makes a difference. So what we're going to do is to add color to this plot, and we're going to color the points according to the number of cylinders that the car has. Okay, let's see. Ah, excuse me, I was still in the correlation call, not in the plot call. In this case, we're going to add the... And what we see here is, like we expected, the cars with a low amount of cylinders really fuel efficient, eight cylinders not so efficient. But as you can see, there's a continuous scale, and we already know that the amount of cylinders in the car is not a continuous scale. So there's a prime example of something where actually the continuous value that is present in the data really needs to be interpreted as a stepwise value. So in this case, we can wrap this color column in the as vector call, and we can really create three buckets, and you can see the plot also picks this up automatically, of cars with a four-cylinder, six-cylinder, or eight-cylinder. And there you can already see some nice clusters emerging. So you, for example, you could use a clustering algorithm to predict whether a car is four, six, or eight cylinders based on their miles per gallon and their horsepower. But in this case, what I'm still interested in is the actual relation between the horsepower and the miles per gallon. So I'm going to add this line of best fit again. But this case, in this case, I'm going to do it for each three of these different clusters. And you can see that the relations inside of the four-cylinder cars and in the six and eight cylinders is quite different. So our first approximation of this single line through all these data points really wasn't that great. And an environment like R really gave me the possibility to explore the data set and to try and find and see what I can learn about it more than just staring at this table with all these values. Well, there's lots of more that we can get out of this, but this is just to give you an idea of the power of the environment. So let's go back to presentation, because I still have some more code for you. And in this case, I wanted to show an example that comes from a site called Kaggle. Kaggle is a platform for competitions between data scientists or aspiring data scientists. And they run a training competition called Titanic Machine Learning from Disaster. And actually what they do is they provide you with a data set of a list of passengers of the Titanic. And in this data set, you get all kinds of attributes. But in the end, the most important column that you get is whether they survived or not. And you're provided with a data set that's called a training data set, which includes this column. And you also get a test training set, which includes all elements except whether the person survived or not. And of course, the idea is to take this training data set and create a model based on this data to predict for each of the passengers in the test data set whether they survived or not. And of course, the better you predict, the higher you score in Kaggle. Actually, what you're going to do is submit the results, so whether they survived or not, of your test training set to Kaggle. They're going to calculate your score, and they have a leaderboard, and it's a very nice place to get started with data science. Don't think you're going to win by just jumping in, because there are some really smart people out there, and really first-timers don't really stand a chance in that sense, but there's lots to learn anyway from watching other people do things as well. So in this case, what I'm going to show you is the fact that we can take a data set and somehow create a model. There are different ways to create models, predictors from a data set. One popular one is, for example, a decision tree. Now, R contains a built-in algorithm to create decision trees from data. And a decision tree actually really is a simple concept. At each node in the tree, you ask the question that separates your data into the most specific separation. So just a very small example, of course, where you can drive this. Sex is female? Yes. Well, then we ask the next question, next question, next question. In the end, by going through this tree, you'll end up in either true or false, whether someone survived or not. The big problem with decision trees is that they're very prone to a something called overfitting. Overfitting means that the model that you create works really well for the data that you used to create the model, but it doesn't really work very well for data, new data that's outside of this model. So really, overfitting is something that you shouldn't want in your models. So there's also an alternative called random forests, because of course, what's better than a tree? A forest. And actually what a random forest algorithm does is that it chops at your data set, your training data set, in even smaller sets, and it creates lots of different decision trees for these subsets of your data. And in the end, it combines all the votes of the different trees for either survive or not survive into a majority. So where the majority vote is the actual outcome for your data point. And it turns out if you do this, that your model is much more robust and much more workable for data that comes from outside of your training set. So let's get back to R Studio. And we're going to move plots out of the way and going to have a quick look at the code. I'll give you a link to GitHub where you can actually look at it at your own pace. I'm going to go through it quickly because it's just to give you the idea of how you could approach such a problem. And in this case, I have a variable called path where my data is stored. And I'm going to define all the data types for the CSV that I'm going to read in, because Kaggle just provides me with the CSV with all the Titanic person data. And I'm going to create a function called loadData, which is going to read, using the read.csv, read the data in. It does some conversion, because I want the age to be an integer. And I do some shuffling, of this data set just to move the survive column to the end. Just if you look at it, it's prettier that way. And then I return this set of information, this CSV that I just read in. Now, of course, I told you I have two sets, one training data and one test data. And obviously, the test data doesn't contain the survived column. So I'm going to remove that from the column types to be read in. Very convenient, again, with the negation here. And then we get to the random forest. And again, what we can do and what we can see here is that we just create a simple function where we provide the columns that we're going to use to build the random forest. And we're going to pass in the data that we have to predict. So that's the test data. And what I do first here is set the random seed just to make things repeatable. Always a good way to start. And I'm going to use the random forest library that is provided from CRAN by R. Now, this random forest library doesn't like it if there are missing values in your dataset. And actually, there are some missing values in the dataset provided by Kaggle. But fortunately, the random forest library also provides us with an imputation function. And imputing data is the act of filling in the blanks using the context of the surrounding data. So actually, what we're going to do here is going to impute our Titanic data set based on the input columns that we provided to this this function. And with this imputed data set, we can actually train our random forest model. What we see here is that we pass in this imputed data set, and we also pass in a so-called formula. And a formula in R is really a way to tell the random forest that I want to predict survived column given, this tilde means given, the rest of the columns. So you could also make a subselection here and just provide some columns if you think that you get better accuracy using fewer data points, which is actually something that you really should experiment with, because more data doesn't always mean that you have a better model. And in this case, well, I'm going to show it, so at least you see something happening when I run it later. And I'm going to use the predict function. And in this predict function, we're going to use the model that was created based on a data set, training set. And I'm going to pass in all these persons who were on the Titanic, for which we have the data, but for who we didn't know whether they survived or not. And in the end, we get the output. And I'm doing a little trick here, because some of the output is left empty, because also the to be predicted data set has some missing values. Of course, we could include these as well, but in this case, I just chose to assign a zero to all this missing data. Because, I mean, I don't know about you, but I've seen the movie Titanic, and it really isn't very likely that you survived it. So now there's some stuff to write a data frame with just a passenger ID and whether they survived or not, and I can send that to Kaggle. And in this case, I'm going to create a function that runs a random forest. It calls my function that I just created. Turns out that these columns taken together give a fairly nice model, so that's what I'm going to run. And I still have to save my source file here, so it's loaded interactively into my environment. And then I can just say, okay, run the random forest. And as you can see, RStudio also provides step completion, which is very handy in some cases. And what's going to happen is that the random forest library is going to create a model based on, in this case, 300 different random trees. And what I get back is a confusion matrix, which indicates to me in how many of the instances the model predicted something correctly. So in this case, it predicted 502 times 0, and it was correct for that prediction. But there was a misprediction in 47 cases, and the other way around, there was a misprediction in 95 of the cases. And you can see the percentages here, the percentage of error. And it estimates that using this model, I'll get an error rate of about 16% when predicting new data outside of my training set. So, of course, this is not something to be very proud of, but on the other hand, it's also really nice. I mean, random guessing gives you a 50% rate. On the other hand, 16% error rate. In this case, brought me to, and let's switch back to the application again. If you run this code, then you will actually end up somewhere very, very, very down on the leaderboard. In this case, you can see place 1549. And this is just a starter. I mean, you can do much, much more to improve your model. And that's actually where the fun starts, when you start experimenting with your data and seeing if you can get more accurate predictions. That's really what data science is about. So if you want to take a closer look at this code and run it yourself, you can look at this bit.ly link that I have shown here, bit.ly / Kaggle-Titanic. And I think we're going to go to the last part of our session. And before, I'm going to check in the Q&A section if there are any questions currently. I see a question about Rangin. We'll get to that. Question about R versus Java 8. Lambda abstractions were introduced, and Java 8 got more functional. True, I think I mentioned that as well, because with the advent of lambdas and more functional programming in Java, the languages are a bit more similar. I think Java still has ways to go with regards to functional programming. But still, it's better in Java 8, agreed. I think there's some more languages, but I'll address some of them at the end. I saw something about Rangin as well, and we'll get to that now. So we've started this nice environment, and in this nice environment, we can do all kinds of cool stuff with data. But then we have our Java applications. So how do we integrate these two worlds? Well, actually, I see three ways in which we could do that. One is actually integrating with the R runtime and R as I showed it to you from your Java application. There's ways to do that. The other is, why not bring R to the JVM? And there's possibilities there as well. And the last one, you can of course also replace whatever you did in R with something in a Java library. And these three options are really the basic choices that you have to make. So the first one, how do you integrate with R from Java? Well, there's the possibility to use R Java and the Java R interface, which are two sides of the same coin, actually. And in this way, you can use native integration to do to call from Java into R, and even the other way around as well, if you want that. So it's a native.
I'm sorry, we cannot see your presentation, the slides. We cannot see them.
Okay. Let me try again. Is it better?
Not yet.
Okay. How about now?
Yes. Now
yes.
See.
Okay. Okay. Sorry about that. I don't know what happens, but man. Every time I try to go full screen, it bumps me out of the WebEx. Let's try it one more time. Yes. Is this better? Okay, excellent. So this is about the R Java and the Java R interface, which is actually a native library that you can link to from a Java application. But beware, it's a GPL license, as far as I know, so you have to deal with that as well. An alternative is to use a TCP connection to an R serve process on the backend, which you can do through the same interface. and which means you don't have to link your application to it, which is can be an advantage. So the code I show here, you instantiate a new R engine, you wait for it to be available, and then you can just eval R code on this this engine, and you get back the result in some horrible R expression data type. And because it's in all these specialized data types, you have to translate back again and back and forth, which isn't really ideal, but well, that's just the way it works with native libraries. And if you do this, I mean, it works, but you're still limited to how R works. And with limited, I mean this memory limitation. So your data set has to fit into memory and even copied more because you're using a JNI library. So beware of that. And it's still a fairly slow interpreter that you're talking to. So while this is possible, it's not the most optimal way to go, in my opinion. Another option that you have is to use a JVM-based R implementation. And Rengin is such an implementation. I know a few others, but this seems to be the one that's really active and maintained. And to me, this is the most promising implementation of R on the JVM. The pros of this is that it's really fast because it's JVM-based. In the sense that there are also parts of it which can run in parallel, which is really not happening in the native R implementation. And a big advantage is just another jar file, right? I mean, you can put it into your application. You can talk to it over the JavaX scripting interface, as you can see here, just creating a new script engine manager. You get it by calling it with the engine name Rengin. Then you can just evolve R code again, just like you did with the previous solution. But in this case, there's no native R implementation running beneath this. It's all handled in the JVM. One downside is that Rengin isn't a 100% complete implementation of the R language. So there are lots of packages that run really well on the on Rengin, but it's not really it doesn't give you 100% coverage. But it's getting better and better, and I really recommend looking at this if you are interested in using this from your Java applications. So what would it look like if you want to share data from your Java application? In this case, for example, an integer array. Well, you can just use the scripting interface to put data into the engine, and you can then eval it using the name that you gave to the data, in this case data. And Rengin takes care of translation between these data types and whatever happens in the Rengin implementation. And the other way around, you can also access your Java code from Rengin. In this case, you see the import, where you can just declare that you want to import a class that you wrote. And you can instantiate objects using the $new syntax, where you can give the variables, even with nice names, etc. You can invoke setters by actually assigning to the, in this case, on the last line, the Tim $name. So it's a pretty nice interaction model between Java and your R code. So while this is a, I believe, nicer solution than using the R native integration, it's still a solution for a single node, right? I mean, you use Rengin, and if you want to process data sets that are larger than your memory, there are ways to do that using Rengin, but it's still not what we would call a big data processing architecture. And of course, you can wonder, I mean, what's really big data, right? Because lots of the data sets that we work with aren't really that big. But there are lots of data sets that are really big, and with really big terabytes, petabytes, whatever, that really necessitate something more scalable than just having this Rengin or R native integration. And then you come into the replace strategy. So you have to look at a scalable infrastructure for data processing, for example, Hadoop, which is of course well known and one of the oldest options there. Another very nice one, I think, is the Spark platform, which is quite a bit faster than Hadoop in many scenarios. And on top of Hadoop, there's, for example, the Apache Mahout library, which contains many machine learning algorithms and algorithms that are also available in R. The problem is that if you start with R and you prototype and you explore and you create a model, etc., then the porting will be quite hard. It will just be a rewrite on top of these infrastructures. So that's not a showstopper often, but it can be a limiting factor. So there are also some very scalable R distributions that you can use as alternative for the more generic JVM-based data processing platforms. One of these is R distribution by Revolution Analytics. This is a commercial R distribution which really builds on top of these scalable architectures as well, on which you can run R code instead of Java code then. And I've even learned that there's a thing called Oracle Enterprise R, in which you can run R code on your Oracle database cluster. So there's options there. I haven't used those personally, but that would be one way to look at it as well, if you want to go for a scalable distribution, but you do not want to leave behind your R code that you created. So we've seen, or we've talked about what data science is. We've seen an introduction to the R language, some demos there, and some integration strategies for your Java-based applications. One last picture that I want to show you here is that it's really a sort of a sliding scale. What should you pick? R is ideally suited for exploring your data, just taking a small sample of your data, play around with it like I did with the empty cars dataset, try and find out what it is that you can learn and what kind of model you can fit on top of your data, because R really has a rich set of libraries with a rich set of possibilities to create models. But then if you approach production and if you want to really use it in a high volume environment, then you might run into trouble using the R native implementation like we discussed. The other option there is to go with Rengine, which is of course something you use from your compiled Java code, which makes it a bit less agile, a bit less suited to this whole discovery and exploration process that I showed you. I mean, you can do that as quickly as I showed you in RStudio. On the other hand, it allows you to scale a bit further than the native R integration. It allows you to have the freedom to just drop in another jar file and use your results from R in your production application. And like I said, if this works for you, I think it's really the best way forward. On the other hand, if you have a much larger scale, which you have to adapt to after you, you've explored your data and you've found your model, then you should really look at these architectures based on Hadoop or on Spark. And yes, you have less choice then in terms of what kind of models you can program to. For example, Mahout does have an implementation of random forests that I showed in R, but it doesn't have a lot of the more exotic models that you can build in R. Well, such is life. It's all about trade-offs in this case. Now, if you want to get started with R, well, obviously, the way to get started is just to install it. I mean, it's open source. Play around with it. There are some pretty nice tutorials online. If you want to get a bit more in-depth introduction, a book that I would recommend is Machine Learning for Hackers from O'Reilly, which is a really great book about machine learning, but all the examples are in R. So it's also a bit of an introduction to the R language and how to use it for problems like classification, prediction models, and all kinds of really cool stuff. There's also a free book called An Introduction to Data Science by Jeffrey Stanton from the Syracuse University, which also uses R as its main language and also introduces a lot of the data science concepts in a hands-on manner. Last, there's a Coursera course called Computing for Data Analysis. And this course, I'm not sure when it starts or if it even starts shortly, but I would highly recommend to follow this one if you like what you saw so far. It will give you a really solid introduction into R and also the applications of R to real-world problems. So with that, I think I'll open the floor for questions some more. And if you want to contact me, here's my Twitter handle. Just fire away. And let me see if I can find the Q&A panel again. There's a question about interaction with Excel. I know there's at least a package in R that you can use to read Excel files, so there's just the file-based integration. There's also lots of other integrations, by the way, for MongoDB, for JDBC-based databases, so you really don't have to work with CSV files. In this case, I'd advise to look at CRN, the RGAF network, and try and find this Excel library, because I know it's there. I don't know the name by heart. There's a question, what's the difference between the arrow and the is operators? And as far as I know, they're functionally equivalent. But the problem is that the is operator is also reused in some other contexts, like, for example, when defining named parameters. And there are some unforeseen interactions when using assignments using the equal sign and this named parameter syntax, which I really don't have an example for now, but lots of people advise just to use the arrow, because then you don't run into these edge cases. But on the other hand, the equal sign is shorter, and many people prefer it, so they happily use it and never run into these edge cases that I talked about. So, well, functionally, they're equivalent. They're just assignment operators. There's another question. Let's see, what is the name about a book with R tips and tricks? I believe that Manning currently has a book, R in Action, as I think I recall it, which is Manning always has really really nice books, at least in my opinion, containing very practical information. Let me see if I can take another question here. Is Python better dealing with big data? That means, are there any scalable systems using Python? I don't have any first-hand experience with building data science-y stuff using Python. I know lots of people are using it, but they're using it in a sense that I'm using R, just for exploratory analysis. And I think lots and lots of people with high-scale applications don't use Python, don't use R, but use these scalable JVM-based architectures that I talked about earlier. So things like Hadoop and like Spark. That being said, I do think that Python scales a bit further than R, if only because Python has lots of different implementations, some very optimized for speed, etc. So I think it does have some of an edge there, but I wouldn't say it's a really great fit for the really large scale applications of data science. You know, is it okay if we take one last question, or what's the process here?
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay, so let's have a look. Okay, here's one which I think is a nice one. A rookie coder needs advice. I know R, and I have some programming skills. I'd like to upgrade my skills. What should I focus on? Renjin, Julia, a new one I mentioned. Anything else? First of all, I'd like to say, if you're interested in these sort of applications, you shouldn't start with coding. You should start with the basics. So try and find a really good and solid statistics course. There's also a really great machine learning course on the Coursera. And at least for me, I didn't really have a big statistical background. I'm still not an expert in statistics, but I've seen that it really forms the basis of everything that comes after that. So really choosing between R or Julia is much less of an issue. I'd say the issue really is get your grips on the theoretical background of statistics and the applications towards data science. And then you can start thinking about, okay, what language? And probably you'll stick with the language that was used in the introductions for the actual theoretical background. I'd say if you really want to make a choice now between one of these languages, I'd really look at not just R, but also pick either Julia or Python plus all the Python editions for data science. And the combination of two of these languages, I think, really gives you a rounded out experience. So that's what I would say for that.